Hello, welcome to our Wednesday seminar. Today, we are very happy to have Jose Blanco-Pillado from the University of the Basque Country. Today, Jose is going to tell us about his interesting work on the dynamics of solitons.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be there, or here, or somewhere in between. So this work I'm going to be talking about today is work I've been doing in collaboration with my student, Daniel Jiménez Aguilar, our postdoc, José Manuel Queiruga, and faculty member Joan Urrestilla that you probably all know. By the way, do you see my pointer? Okay, very good.
Yes, we do.
All right, so the outline of the talk is the following. I'll give you first some motivation of why we have started all this program, which as you will see is not just one particular type of soliton. We just actually sampling several different dimensions and different field theories. And in particular, I'll concentrate first in the main wall excitations, which are the simplest ones. And therefore, this is the perfect field theory place to start, because everything is very clear, things are analytic, and you have a lot of control over the things. Then we move on to the next more complicated thing, which is global vortices, which is in two dimensions. And you will already see that there are quite important differences between these things. And then I'll move on to work in progress that we are doing at the moment. So, I mean, really, as we speak, like an hour before the talk, I was talking to Danny about some of the simulations. So, and this is the idea of taking these ideas to higher dimensions. And here I mean higher dimensions of the soliton themselves, like not just points, not just points in two dimensions, but actually, for example, strings in 2+1 dimensions or 3+1 dimensions. And then I'll conclude with the future work that we are planning to do. Okay, so the motivation is pretty clear. Most of you probably are familiar with solitons. Solitons have been around in field theory for, well, I mean, in many different areas of physics, but in particular in field theory, which is the context I'm going to talk about today. They have been around for a long time. And if you look at any description on solitons, for example, if you look at Tangmei's book, then you will see that most of the discussion is about how you can see the lowest any configurations of these objects. So a typical example is a topological soliton, an object whose stability is guaranteed by the topology, meaning that is the field theory configuration with the lowest energy given the boundary conditions and infinity. Okay, so this is a typical thing that people study. And you can do it yourself in a computer. You put some initial condition, which is arbitrary, but that satisfies the good boundary conditions that you need. And then you let the object relax by any method that you want. And the energy is going to be flying away, but what is left behind is the object of the lowest energy configuration. And that's the soliton. That's what people normally do. And then they study the motion or whatever. On the other hand, we also know that there are in other field theories, there are long-lived excitations of field theory, which are not necessarily solitons, and they go by the names of pulsons or oscillons or excitons, whatever. I mean, they go different names in different dimensions. And these things are not solitons, but they share many of the properties of the solitons. They have a concentrated energy in some region of space, and this energy doesn't dissipate to infinity easily. In fact, it takes a very long time to dissipate. Now, what we want to talk about today is something which is a hybrid between these two things, between the solitons and between the oscillons, which is excited solitons. So the solitons that have excitations that live for a very, very long time. And what I mean by a very long time is much longer times than the times that you would naively attribute to the soliton. So typically a soliton has a width, a thickness, and this is basically the length scale, but it's also the time scale that you normally expect the perturbations to be, or the excitations to be around the soliton. In other words, if you put if you create the soliton in the way I was saying before, in a field theory in the computer, the time it takes for the extra energy to be released and go to infinity is of the order of the light crossing time of the soliton, right? So it shouldn't stay there for a long time. This is the normal type of excitation. However, there are models, and in particular the ones I'm going to be talking about, where there are very long lived excitations, such a long time, which is much, much longer than the thickness of the object, that in some sense resembles as if you were putting an oscillon in, on top or inside of the soliton. Okay. So what we are set to study, or we were interested in, is to understand questions related to these excited solitons. Questions like how much energy can we store in these solitons in this way? And what are the effects of these excitations, long-term excitations, in the dynamics of the objects? In particular, we are interested in this because of this long debate that we were discussing a few minutes ago, the long debate between field theory simulations and cosmic streams. So we have the idea that maybe it is possible that these excited states could play some role in understanding this field theory simulation. So that's why we were interested in studying this thing. But as you can imagine, studying this in a network of cosmic streams is extremely complicated. If you want to extract information, you have to start with baby steps or simple problems. So we started with the simplest problem we can think of, which is the domain wall in 1+1 dimensions. So the field theory that we are studying is the simplest one, again, where you can find a soliton. It's a simple scalar field, real scalar field, which is this phi, which has this Mexican hat potential of this form. So you have the parameter lambda and the symmetry breaking scale eta. So in this theory, you have, of course, the two vacua, which is phi equals to eta and minus eta. And around these vacua, these two vacua, you have excitations on the vacuum, which have a mass, which actually, if you write it in terms of these parameters, is of the order of eta square root of lambda. Okay, so these are the excitations around the vacuum. But then we know that this theory has non-perturbative excitations that go by the name of domain walls or kinks that interpolate between the two vacua, one of the phi equals to eta and phi equals to minus eta. In particular, in this case, and this is the nice thing of starting with this simple problem, that you can find the exact solution of this soliton that interpolates between minus one and one, and then you multiply by eta. So is the solution of the lowest energy configuration that interpolates between these two vacua. So this hyperbolic tangent only varies from the vacuum in a region which is of the order of the inverse of the mass. So the thickness of the soliton is of the order of the inverse of the mass. And this is described here. You see the interpolation between one region and the other on a range of the order one in these units. And if you plot the NA density, again, the NA density is also not zero, only in a region which is of the order of one over n. Okay, this is very good. This, by the way, this object can be placed any place, and this is this X naught. So you can move it without any cost, if anything. So what we want to do is to study perturbations of this domain wall. So we study the background solution, which I call here phi k, is supposed to be the k of kink, plus some perturbations. These perturbations depend on the space and time. So I plug this into the equations of motion, I linearize the equations that I get, and I get this equation. Double dot is the derivative with respect to time. This is the prime is the derivative with respect to space. Now, if I assume that this perturbation just oscillates with a frequency omega, like e to the minus I omega t, I arrive at an equation that should be familiar to all of you, because it's nothing more than the Schrödinger equation for this effective potential u of x. And in fact, this u of x is this thing over here, this thing that multiplies psi here. Okay. So we can plot this potential, potential for the Schrödinger problem. And then we can use all the machinery from quantum mechanics that we learned in the first few years of not graduate, undergraduate, to compute the spectrum of this Schrödinger problem. So one interesting thing about, well, one thing that you should remember is that this effective potential has this asymptotic of the order of the value of m squared, okay? And then it goes below zero. So one thing that you may worry is that it's going, you're going to have some negative mode. This, of course, would signal an instability. But of course, we know that there's no instability because we know that the object is topologically stable. So we can actually find the exact spectrum in this case of the bound states and the scattering states, everything in full glory. You can find actually the spectrum, but also the eigenfunctions in a analytic way. And this is why this is a very good problem to start with. So you can find the zero mode, the one that describes the rigid displacement of the whole object, which in some sense is the is just the Goldstone mode of the breaking of the Lorentz of the translation invariance, right? The fact that the object is in one place and not in others. The wave function can be found analytically. It has this shape, which well, it has the shape that it's supposed to from quantum mechanics. It doesn't have any node. Now the next one is a bound state. It's below the asymptotic threshold. It has a frequency which is given by the square root of 3/2 times the mass of the vacuum excitations. Its wave function have this antisymmetric form. It has one node as it's supposed to be as the first excited state, okay? Then after that, you get all the scattering states. There's a continuum starting at m squared that go all the way to infinity, right? You have all the scattering states. Scattering states, you can, as I said, you can find them analytically as well. And they have the property that you would expect, that they change a little bit in the part of the potential in the center, but then asymptotically, they are going to be like plane waves, okay? So they are like propagating particles and outside, which start at the value that we set, m squared. Okay, this is great. We have all the spectrum. So what does this, well, okay, so the interesting state is, of course, this one. The one that is a bound state, okay? It's an excited state from the object, okay? And what we're interested in is to see what happens if you excite it. So we can put it in the computer, we put the kink solution, and we add to this kink solution this mode, which sometimes goes by the name of the shape mode, that's why we call it F of S, with some amplitude that you fix to be, I think in this case was 0.4, I don't remember exactly, I think it's 0.4. And then you let it evolve with the quiescent motion and do a movie and you get this, okay? So what you see is that the kink doesn't, or the domain wall doesn't move, the point where phi is equal to zero is in the same place. So the zero mode is not excited. And what is excited is this shape mode, that what it does is exactly that, it changes the shape. Okay, if you look at it, what it does is it makes it fatter at some point and then slimmer at some point, right? It's like a breathing mode, if you want. Okay. All right, so we want to understand the evolution of this long-term evolution of these modes. So naively, you would say, well, this is a very long, I mean, this is going to be staying forever. And this is actually said by some people sometimes, but it's, in fact, it's not true. The argument, the naive argument is to say that because it's a mode, you can put it and it's going to stay there forever. This argument relies on the fact that you're only studying linearized equations, right? So if you only study linearized equations, the bound state stays there forever, of course. And the reason why it cannot decay is because by definition, the bound state has a frequency which is smaller than the spectrum of particles that can propagate in the vacuum. So therefore, it will never propagate in the vacuum. Another way of saying this is, well, this bound state cannot mix at the linear level with the other ones because by definition, they are at the linear level, they would be independent of one another. But at the nonlinear level, they will mix. And the way you can understand that is because if you imagine a term in the equations of motion, which are quadratic, that oscillates with frequency omega s, now that you square it, is going to be a term that has a double the frequency. And if you double the frequency of the Shape mode, that number is above the frequency of the scattering states, the beginning of the scattering states. That means that there's going to be radiation. So the best way to describe the field is going to be a sum of three terms, the one that has to do with the static kink, the one that has to do with the Shape mode, with the excitation, whose amplitude now is going to change with time. And then we have another term, which is going to be the outgoing radiation, right? So we want to calculate how much is this outgoing radiation, because we want to know how long is this excited state going to stay around. In other words, what we would like to know is how this A of S depends on time. So this was done by Nick Manton and Merabet a few years ago. And it's a nice piece of work. What they did is basically studied the next order in the coexistence of motion, where they realized that if you put this excited state, it acts as a source for the radiation wave function, as a source which is quadratic, okay? Now, if you integrate this equation, and in fact, they actually did integrate this equation, well, the first thing that you notice is that the radiation waveform has twice the frequency of the Shape mode, okay? This is just because this term at the lowest order is the quadratic term. And then you also realize that the amplitude goes with the amplitude of the Shape mode square. Now, once you get this solution, you can compute the energy stored in this outgoing wave. And now, just by conservation of energy, if the energy is leaking from the object, it must be that it's coming out from the original energy that you had. But the original energy had two terms. One was the static one, and the other one was the excited state. The static one you cannot get rid of, so it must come from the energy of the excitation. So now you can compute what is the evolution of the excitation, or the amplitude of the excitation, as a function of time, just by saying it has to decrease at the same rate as the energy is coming out. Okay. If you do this calculation, a formula you get is this, which is not very illuminating in its form. So I digested a little bit here. So you can see that there is a time scale, which I call TD, which in units of the light crossing time of the soliton is 100 times the original amplitude at the power minus 2. And when you are at times below that time or before that time, then the amplitude pretty much stays constant, right? And then after that time, the amplitude decreases with a power law, like t to the minus 1/2. So you can see that, you can see that if the amplitude is really small, let's say 10 to minus 1, right? Doesn't have to be that small. If you take just 10 to minus 1, this number is much, much bigger than the sort of naive time scale that you would associate with the object, right? Particularly if you take 10 to minus 2, this number is extremely large. So if you're doing a simulation, in particular simulation like the one I have in my background, you don't have to think about only the scale or the thickness of the object, but you also have to think about what is the time scale of your box? Because these objects could be around for much longer time than the time scale of your box, and that's typically the time scale of your simulation. So that's why these things could become important, because they can stay around for the duration of your simulation. I mean, normally people think, okay, you know, I mean, myself included, we always thought that, okay, excitations of solitons exist, but they are transient, they disappear fast. And what this argument says is that no, I mean, they will disappear at some point, but they may take a very long time. Okay, so we wanted to test this analytic prediction with numerical simulations. So for that, we did it in a 1+1 dimensional lattice. Now, in order to do a thorough check, what you should do is be able to extract directly from the simulation the value of the amplitude and compare it with this expression I just said to you. So the way you do this is you simulate this in a computer, and then you get your numerical phi, right? And this you decompose into the kink solution, the background static solution, plus the shape mode with the amplitude and the radiation. So you, if you subtract this numerical solution minus the background, then you can project it over the shape mode because the different modes are orthogonal. This is just because if you look at the original Schrödinger problem, you know that they have to be orthogonal. So if you just project them in this way, you know that the projection is going to be the amplitude of whatever it is multiplying the shape mode.
Okay. The phi is something you get. How do you get the phi?
This phi here, this is something I get from the numerical evolution.
So by some formation?
Yeah, I'll explain in a second.
Yeah, okay.
It's actually this. So here it is. This is the phi. This is the initial condition for phi. This is the same thing I showed before, except that now has an amplitude of 0.6, okay, 0.6. So this is a static initial condition. I have the kink solution in the background plus 0.6 times the shape mode, okay? And then I'm going to evolve it in this box. Now, the only other thing I have to tell you is that we are doing absorbing boundary conditions. We are performing those whole thing in absorbing boundary conditions at the end. The reason to do this is because, as I explained before, what we expect is that this thing oscillates and is going to be leaking energy, right? But very slowly. If you don't have a way to absorb the energy, then the energy would bounce off the wall, come back to you, and re-excite the whole thing again. So if you want to know how this thing de-excites in a realistic situation where you would have, you know, the whole universe to to eject the energy. Of course, you don't want to do this. You don't want to do the whole universe in your simulation because you don't have numerical resources to do it. So this trick of putting the boundary conditions, absorbing boundary conditions, is a nice trick. So here, these are different panels. This one, as I said, is the full phi of x and t. Here, I take that solution and I subtract the kink. So then you see that you have the nice wave function of the excited, the shape mode, the one I showed you before. It's the initial state, okay? Here is, if I take the field, I subtract the static one and I subtract also the shape mode with the amplitude that I think it should have. And what I'm saying that I think I should have is the one that I extract directly from the simulation by this projection. Okay, so this one over here is the projection that we get directly from the simulation. So now if we run this in time, we see this thing oscillates as I said, the mode oscillates as it should, but then you see something leaking out, which is exactly just this. And I plot this because then you see that this is really a uniform wave with just one single frequency, okay? Which is twice the frequency of the excited state. And the bound state amplitude is basically pretty much constant. It declines a little bit, and it should decline a little bit because the energy is leaking out, okay? So I don't know if you want to see this again, because you may have concentrated one, you can move to the other ones, okay? So here is the excitation and the radiation. Here's only the radiation. And when it gets to the boundary, you can look, it's not bouncing off. It's really absorbed. It's as if it was going through, right? Actually, because in this case, we know exactly the frequency, you can tune the absorbing boundary conditions even better. You do a more efficient way. You know exactly what is coming. So it's like, you know, it's much better than your headphones because it's as if you were putting headphones knowing what is being thrown to you. So you know exactly what you should cancel it with. Okay, so as I said, this was a very small period of time. If we do this in a very, very long time, what we get is this. This is the amplitude of the perturbation as a function of time in units of the period, one oscillation. Now, if you look at very small times, you see this, the same thing I showed you before, an oscillating value of the amplitude. And because now we start with a very small amplitude, the amplitude is exactly constant, or yeah, almost exactly constant at the beginning. And then it declines. And this, by the way, this purple thing is just the sum of all these oscillations, but there are so many of them that you just see everything everything cover. Is that understood more or less? Okay. And the black line is the theoretical expectation or prediction from Manton et al. Okay, so you see this theoretical prediction is perfect when you go to very small values of the initial amplitude. The next thing that you should notice is that here you have 20, but it's multiplied by 10 to the 4. So this is 2 times 10 to the 5 oscillations. It's 200,000 oscillations. So it's a huge, huge number of oscillations. And the amplitude has declined only from 0.02 to 0.01 or a little bit less. Okay. So this is the argument that these things kind of stay there for a very, very long time. Okay.
And so what's the number of TD in this example?
Oh, right. The number of T is of the order of 10 to the 5 times the thickness of the object. So okay. If you, of course, here you see a decline, but if you were to plot this in a log plot, you would see pretty much constant and then the decline. And the decline would be around 10 to the 5. Okay. Of course, if you do it in linear, this nice kink is hard to see. But so, right, if you start with a very small value like this one, this number is very large. You may now wonder if things would change if I go to a very large amplitude. So we did, we put an amplitude of 1, which is very large. So here, the TD is much smaller because the TD depending on the inverse of the amplitude of the square. Okay, so this now should be of the order of 100. And then you see, yeah, of the order of 100. Things have changed quite a bit, okay? But still, the interesting thing about this simulation is that this prediction, the quantitative theoretical prediction is still pretty good. This was a little bit surprising when we found this. I was not expecting this because I thought that, whole calculation assumes linearity everywhere, right? And 1 is not linear by any means, in the sense that if you look at the extra energy that you added to the kink by putting a shape mode with amplitude 1 is more than the original energy. So you double its energy, okay? So it's really not a perturbation it's a perturbation of more than order 1. So it doesn't make sense to treat this numerically as linear, but. But anyway, the prediction seems to work pretty well. So then the question is, how far can we push this, right? Because one of the questions that we wanted to address is how much energy can we store in these things? So the idea is that you can push this until you go to really, really large amount of energy. So if you go to energies bigger than 3 times the energy of the domain wall, then what you see is this. The thing tries to oscillate, but then eventually breaks, right? Because it has enough energy, the original system has enough energy to have 3 separate domain walls, right? And what it does is to separate in 3 domain walls. 1 is this one, the other one is an anti-kink, and another one is a kink. And some extra energy because they put more. So you can play this game where you put a little bit less than 3, and then what this does is separates and then comes back, separates and come back. Then if you put exactly this, it's like, it seems that it separates forever, but almost at the zero velocity, okay? So this is the limit. It seems that you cannot go beyond this amount of energy, which still is a huge amount of energy, right? If you were to think about solitons with 2 times the energy, it would mean that you should not think about the lowest energy configuration, because it seems that you can store all this amount of energy, right? So,
by the way, I think Nick Manton also had a paper on this.
Oh, he did? Okay.
Yeah, that where the shape mode produces.
I think he commented on this on the original one, the one I mentioned before. I don't know if he actually did
another. I seem to remember a paper as well.
Okay, so maybe you can tell me about it.
Yeah.
Okay, so if we have this picture in mind that you can store energy all the way to very large amount of energy, then the question is, okay, this is the maximum you can store, but the question that is more interesting is, what is the typical energy that these objects have in a realistic situation or semi-realistic situation? So for that, we did a simulation of a formation of these domain walls. It's a very crude, but it's still a simulation of the phase transition that produces these domain walls. So what we did is we started with an initial state that was at the top of the potential. So phi is equal to almost zero everywhere. And it has these fluctuations. These fluctuations are a thermal state on top of the field phi equals to zero. So we assume that the potential at the beginning has a parabolic shape at phi close to phi equals to zero. And then from this initial state, we abruptly change it to the Mexican hat, okay? Now, if you do this, then of course you have a huge amount of energy everywhere because you have all the potential energy from the top of the potential. So you will not form nice kinks, because you have a huge amount of energy. So you need some way to dissipate this energy. So one thing that we did, of course, is absorbing boundary conditions, but that's not even enough. You have to, you want to dissipate faster than that. Of course, you can put a friction term. But if you put a friction term, you're also going to kill what you want to observe, which is the bound state, right? Because the bound state oscillates. So if you put friction, then it's just going to go to zero. So what we did is to put this system in the sitter space. If we put it in the sitter space, it helps you with the friction because you have a cosmological friction in such a way that all the waves that you would form, maybe I should put the movie in that you can start seeing it. So what happens is that different regions go to different parts of the vacuum. Some go to one, some go to minus one, and you form kinks and anti-kinks in between these regions. And as I said, the fact that you're in the sitter space helps you to, first of all, that the kinks do not move very fast and go to the boundary and get absorbed. Also that there is a lot of radiation in the background. And in order to do this, the only thing that you have to do is to make sure that your Hubble horizon distance is bigger than the thickness of the object, or basically the scale associated with bound state. If you do that, the bound state can still oscillate and is not being damped by the cosmological expansion. Okay, so here you see 1, 2, 3, 4 kinks and anti-kinks. And then you see some other things, right? Some other things that you may say, okay, what are those? Well, those are the so-called oscillons in this theory, which they also exist. These are these long-term oscillations that I was talking about before. These are known to exist even this theory as well. And of course, in the phase transition, they are formed. Okay, so here we zoom in into this one on the right, just for you to see, because we are running in commoving coordinates, the kink seems to be shrinking. And it's hard to see anything there to see if it is vibrating or not. But if you zoom in, you can see it. And this is the same movie, but just zoom in this part, okay? So you see that the kink forms. It's moving a little bit to the right and it's oscillating. And here's the amplitude readoff from here, okay? So we can read off the amplitude of each individual kink. Then we did a lot of these simulations. Sorry. So at the end, as I said, it's shrinking in commoving size, but it's pretty much the same type of simulation at the end that the ones I showed you earlier, right? And then you can read off the amplitude from there. So for each simulation, we read off the amplitude of this excited state. And for example, for one particular simulation here, you see that most of them, most of the kinks, these are different kinks. Most of the kinks have pretty much the same amplitude. Okay. So after 500 simulations, we infer that the amplitude of the original shape mode is of the order 0.5, which if you translate it into energy, it means that the kinks are formed with 20% of extra energy, okay? Now, if you ask, what is this energy coming from? Well, it comes from the actual formation, from the energy that is in the background. And there is another effect, which is that these oscillons sometimes hit the domain wall and then excite this domain wall, okay? So sometimes we even saw things which were almost like getting stuck by the domain wall. So we know that the kinks kind of store a lot of energy, but in fact, information seems to only go to 20%. That's one of the results. Another possibility that we explore was the idea that you put a kink in contact with a thermal background. So here's the original kink plus perturbations, which is described by a thermal state. And if you do this, well, at the beginning it's a lot of noise, but then eventually, first of all, the kink has moved, and then all the rest of the garbage radiation has been absorbed in the boundaries. And the only radiation that is left is this nice oscillating thing, which is the shape mode. So clearly the shape mode is the longest lived excitation of the kink. No matter how you create it or how you perturb it with some thermal state or whatever, everything else disappears. And at the end, you're left with the kink with this shape mode, okay? Now, we calculate the amplitude of the shape mode for different temperatures. And we saw, a simple trend. But the most interesting thing about this, that was increasing with temperature, and the most interesting thing is that this amplitude saturates at some particular temperature. And we think we understand what that is. This amplitude is, by the way, the same 0.5 value that we observe in the formation of the domain wall. The reason of this coincidence, which is not a coincidence, is that at this is a very high temperatures. So in reality, the amount of energy that you have in the background at this thermal state is so high that your perturbations your fluctuations are so large that you're all basically going over the top of the barrier. So in reality, you cannot say that at these temperatures, you are heating up the kink, because the background energy in the thermal state is larger than the kink, right? So in some sense, this is going like to the thermal phase transition. Okay, so it's not surprising that it's the same value as the one we found before. Okay, this is the end of the domain wall part. So is there any question about this part? No? Okay. So then we move on to global vortices, which is, as I said, the second or the next simplest thing that you can think of, which is in 2+1 dimensions. Now we have a complex scalar field. This phi is now a complex scalar field, but the potential is the same, except that now it has it's two-dimensional in field space. So it's a Mexican hat with a vacuum manifold, which is a circle, right? Where the modulus of phi is equal to eta. Now the vacuum in this field theory has 2 degrees of freedom. One that is a massive one that has to do with the radial direction of phi, and the other one that is massless, which has to do with the axionic part, the angular part, right? And this is important because it characterizes a type of solitons, their interactions. So it's quite important that they have 2 degrees of freedom, one that is massive and the other one that is massless. In terms of the soliton solution that you can find, is described in this form, where you have a function f that depends on the radial coordinate. So rho is the radial coordinate from the center of the vortex, theta is the angular part around the vortex. So you see that the in real space, as you go around at infinity, what the field does is winds around the vacuum manifold. And if you plug these ansatz into the equations of motion, you get a solution for f of rho, which is written here. It goes to zero at the center. So it goes to the top of the potential. And it has two parts, if you want. The core part, which has a thickness, which is of the proportional to the inverse of eta, which is the part where the field is close to the top of the potential. Okay, and then it approaches the vacuum, but because of the particular form of the equations, this approach to the vacuum is not exponential; it's a power law. Okay, and this is actually important for what I'm going to say in a minute. The other important thing, of course, is that when you go to infinity, the gradient of the phase of the complex scalar field is not killed by any other vector field, like in local strings, and therefore you have a very long tail of the any density. This means, there are different consequences of this. The first one is that you can write the energy of the vortex as the sum of two parts. One that has to do with the core, which has to do with the profile of F, and has to do with the radial excitations, okay, or radial profile. And then the second part that has to do with this gradient of the phase that I was talking about before, right? So one nice way to think about global vortices in two dimensions is like charged particles. So in this analogy, the mass of the charged particle would be the energy in the core, and the energy associated with the electromagnetic field around the charged particle will be associated with the second term. So that already tells you, this analogy already tells you that if you have two vortices, they are going to have long range interactions, okay? Which is the attraction because of attraction or repulsion because of the charges. And this is actually going to be important later on. Okay, so we can do the same type of argument that that we did for the kink. And this, as I said, was done before also by Tanney, by also by Mark, Heimarsch, and Woodman. In fact, we also did it, and we all missed something important, but different degrees, we missed different things. So the argument is pretty much the same as before, right? You take the field phi and you decompose the background solution, which is static, and then you add some perturbation. In this case, I'm adding a radial perturbation, I mean the radial mode, with some frequency omega. Putting this into the equations, I get this effective Schrödinger equation now in two dimensions, right? This is the equation in two dimensions. And effective potential is all this. Now the interesting thing, and this is why it's important what I said before, the way you approach, this is the effective potential for the Schrödinger equation. But the way you approach the asymptotic value is only as a power law. And in fact, if you look at your favorite book in quantum mechanics, you can find out that if depending on how your potential reaches your asymptote, you can find examples where the number of bound states is infinite. And in fact, this is one of them. For example, I can remind you that the Coulomb potential in three dimensions is of this form. You have an infinite number of states, and they are all piling up very close to the threshold, but there are an infinite number of them, okay?
Isn't that the hydrogen atom?
Yes, the Coulomb, yes.
Oh, sorry, Coulomb, right. But it happened in 2D also, you see?
Yes. Okay. So we were almost there, but this was pointed out to us by Toman Roman Chukiewicz. So what we did before we knew this is we identify two of these modes numerically. So here are the shapes of the modes, the wave functions of the modes. This is the first one that was also identified earlier. It has, well, the typical shape. than you would think. And the second one, well, has another node, as you would expect, because it's the next excited state. But I want to point out that the scale here of these two pictures are very different. So this guy is much more delocalized, if you want. And it's also suspected because the frequency is much closer to the scattering states, which in this case is one, right? Now, it took us a long time to convince ourselves that this was real, because, you know, when you see something like 0.99, you say, okay, maybe this is numerical error. But at the end, we were convinced, well, by different experiments that we did numerically. For example, we were exciting this thing, this vortex, in two dimensions by anything. And if you put in a small box, you don't get this, but if you put in a big box, then you start seeing this excitation lasting for a very long time. So then we were convinced that this was real because we were not putting it by hand, okay? Of course, if you put it by hand, it also oscillates forever, but you can be maybe thinking, okay, maybe this is the way, it's a subtle thing of the equations, but if you see the merging by itself without putting it there, it's real, right? In any case, there are not only these two, there's an infinite amount of them from this point in 0.9979 to one, okay? Now, of course, again, if you go to look at this Schrodinger problems in quantum mechanics, the wave functions of these things get larger and larger and larger, logarithmically larger. Okay, so the next one is not going to be 100, it's going to be at a distance of 10,000. Okay, so it is basically impossible to track all these modes in a simulation, numerical simulation. On the other hand, it's also not probably important because most of these things are going to have a kink and a vortex and an anti-vortex or another vortex at a distance which is smaller than the presence of these modes. So, you know, it doesn't make sense to study a mode whose wave function is larger than the distance of the other vortex. Okay. That's why we stick to these two for practical reasons, but I think it's also reasonable to do. So this is the same type of diagram that I showed you earlier for the first mode, for the one that is more localized. So it's the same type of panel. This is the profile of the field. This is the perturbation, this is the radiation and the amplitude read off from the numerics. Okay, again, you see a very nice wave that is propagating outwards. This is, by the way, done only in the radial direction because the whole problem has a azimuthal symmetry. So you can do this simulation. But we've done it also in two dimensions without using the fact that this is radial and the results are the same. So it's just, this is much more cost effective because you can do a lot of points here. And this is the second mode, which as I said, is much larger. So that's why this looks much smaller, okay? But again, it has a very nice profile, which extends very far, but it oscillates for a long time. Okay, so this is basically the same idea as in the kink, but in the vortex. So we can ask the same question. Can we find the way in which this amplitude of these modes decay? So we did this in a recent paper with Daniel and Jose Manuel. And so, we follow the same argument as Manton et al., but we basically did it for this particular two-dimensional problem. It's a little bit more complicated because the Green's functions are not known analytically because the modes are not known analytically, so you have to work a little bit harder numerically. But as you can see, it seems that the prediction is pretty accurate. Oh, wait, this is jumping. So it's the same. This is the same graph as before. Is the amplitude of the first mode as a function of time. The black line is the theoretical prediction, and this is the numerical calculation. So it works perfectly for both, for the first mode and the second mode. Now, one interesting thing is that the second mode takes a much longer time to decay. This can be traced to the fact that the the way in which this parameter here that controls the time is calculated depends on the overlap between the radiation wave functions and the source. So if this overlap is smaller, then the amount of radiation that leaks is smaller also. And then therefore it takes more time.
Is this still 1 over square root of t?
Yes, yes. If you rewrite this in the, yeah, it's the same.
And can you see that behavior analytically?
Yes. Yeah, sorry, I didn't put the numbers, but yeah, in the paper we have this, we have the whole description of how to do this analytically. Okay, so, well, analytically, the expression, the coefficients you have to calculate numerically, because here you don't have the wave functions analytically. Okay, so we've identified the excitations for the global vortex. So now we want to do the same, we ask the same question as before. How much energy is stored in their formation? So we did a simulation in a two-dimensional lattice of a thermal state that forms vortices. Now the point is that now we have a problem because the vortices see one another and they annihilate, right? So this is where doing the simulation in the Sitter space also becomes interesting, because if you didn't do it in this space, of course the end result will be no vortex, right? Or maybe one or something. But if you put in the Sitter space, eventually the vortex distance is such that the expansion does not allow them to go to move closer. So that's why you can end up with some vortices. I don't know if you can see them, but here they are annihilating. Here's 1, 2, and 3. Do you see them? So once we get to this part, we move on to from the Sitter space to Minkowski space, and we can read off the amplitude of the vortices directly from the simulation. And in this case, we notice that the amount of energy is much smaller than the one in the kink case. So if you look at the extra energy that you get at formation and the core, it's just less than 4% of extra energy. So this is a difference with respect to the domain wall. We also did the thermal state. So we put a thermal state of one vortex, and then you see that the vortices move around by the thermal fluctuations. And when you when the fluctuations redshift and they are absorbed by the boundaries, you end up with a vortex, which you can read of the amplitude. We did the same thing with calculating the amplitude for different temperatures, and the same process happens, that it saturates for the same reason as before, that you are at very high temperature, you are basically in a soup which is too hot for the vortex to really, you know, to be just a vortex. In fact, at these high temperatures, you start seeing vortex, anti-vortex popping up, right? So it's not really a heated vortex anymore, is like a soup now. Okay, so by the way, again, the amplitude is of the order of 0.1, 0.2 at most, so the energy is small compared to the original vortex energy. Now, this is the energy at the beginning at formation. So we thought, okay, because the dynamics of global vortex is very different from kinks, because the things are being accelerated by the interaction with other vortices, right? And acceleration can excite the internal state, where you can in principle excite it. Also, they have annihilations. And when you have annihilations, they radiate all the energy. This energy could be absorbed for the next one. The next one can get excited, right? So all these complicated dynamics, we thought, is going to change the result compared to the original state. So what we did is a cosmological simulation. What does it mean to do a cosmological simulation? So we did a 2x2 field theory, where we started with this famous Bacchus-Patti-Vilenkin initial conditions, and we let it evolve for a while, following the same procedure that people do for field theory, three-dimensional field theory. Cosmic streams, right? So the idea was to mimic exactly the procedures that they do. And we did it also in an expanding universe and radiation-dominated universe. So this is just a small portion of the whole plane of the simulation. And I'm showing you a picture of all this part only, so you can see things. Otherwise, it's too big to see anything. So here you see all the vortices and anti-vortex. They are moving. Some of them are annihilating each other, right? And you see all these nice ripples of the annihilation that are left behind. So assuming that these things are going to excite all these modes as well, right? And we end up the simulation when we reach the sort of a scaling or the analogous situation to scaling in two dimensions, okay? Okay, which at this point is going to be soon, I hope. Because otherwise, okay, here you go. So when we get to that point, we read off the amplitude of the vortices. But unfortunately, what we see, fortunately, what we saw is that the amount of energy in the end result is actually even less than the original one. Now you may think, how is that possible? Because if you start with some energy, it should last for a long time. Why is it going to be less afterwards? Well, as I said, the beginning of each of these vortices each of these vortices that we have at the end had a very complicated journey from the beginning, right? It had to go through a lot of radiation. It had to, some of them interact with what is left behind from other vortices, et cetera. And in fact, what we think is sometimes the process of radiation can make less excited the vortex, okay? De-excite the vortex, all right? I guess it's right. The analogy that I use is as if you have a glass with water and it's only half the glass and you put more than half, then what you're left behind maybe is less than you started with, okay? Because it goes over and then it's less. Well, maybe not a very good analogy, but in any case, we did some simulations of this kind with a vortex, and we excited the vortex with radiation. And sometimes the energy is stored in the vortex, and sometimes the energy at the end is less than what you started with. So that's why we think it's just...
Jose, this is a 3D simulation, right?
2+1.
2+1, I see.
So they are vortices. They are not, they don't have... They're not the string.
Okay.
All right. So this the case for global vortices seems to be less interesting for excited states because it seems to store less energy. Okay. So now, okay, I think I went a little bit over time, but if I can have a few minutes, I'll tell you what we are doing at the moment, which is interesting, I think. Do I have some minutes?
Yeah, please go on.
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah.
All right. So the next step is to go to 2+1 dimensions. So the next step is to go to higher dimensions. Right? So the simplest thing that we can do is to take the domain wall that was in 1+1 and extend it to 2+1. Right. Now in 2+1, this object now is not going to be a point, it's going to be a line. So it's like a string, but it's now a string in 2+1 dimensions. So this is, as I said, it's just the next step. Now, of course, the perturbations that we studied before are now going to be promoted to fields living on the wall in this 1+1 dimensional wall, right? So the zero mode that describes the wiggles on this string are massless fields in this 1+1 dimensional wall sheet. And the shape mode is now a massive field in 1+1 dimensions, right? So what we want to do is to find effective action for this theory. Now, without the bound excitations, we know the effective action. At least the idea is that the simplest action that you can think of, the number of actions, should describe the wiggles, the excitations of the domain wall, right? So you can do a simulation where you put some standing wave on the wall by hand. Okay, now this of course is incorrect, because the initial state that you put is going to be excited in the wrong way. It's going to have extra energy. But then, because we have this absorbing boundary conditions, we can let it evolve for a long time. And then after we are confident that all the initial energy, extra energy has been leaked, has been ejected, we can reconstruct the position of the string and compare it to the Nambu-Goto. Okay? And this is what this movie does. This is the reconstruction in white of the Nambu-Goto position compared to the field theory after the field theory has evolved for a while. Okay? And you can see that the reconstruction is pretty good. So we are pretty confident that the Nambu-Goto action is a good representation of the evolution of the domain wall. Now, for this, it's important that the frequency of this standing wave is small enough. Okay? If you put a high frequency, of course, you may have some radiation. Okay, so how do we update this action to include the shape mode? Well, as I said, this shape mode is a massive field living in the wall sheet of the domain wall. So without this second part, this is the Nambu-Goto action. And this is the sort of the covariant version of the 1+1 dimensional massive field living on the wall sheet of the induced metric gamma. Okay, so this is sort of like, this is the induced metric, which is the same one as appear here. And theta is this amplitude of the shape mode that we were talking about before. Now, this should be the right action when we disregard radiation, right? Because this is all living on the wall sheet. The radiation lives outside. So if you have a scalar field with some mass and you let it evolve from some amplitude, it's going to oscillate forever. Of course, we know this is not the case, right? Because it's going to radiate to the outside. So this is only good for times smaller than the time decay that I mentioned earlier, right? And so one way that we can say, how is this excited state going to change the evolution of the domain wall? One way that we can parameterize this is by looking at the change in the equation of state of the domain wall. So let's take a time which is larger than the oscillation of the excited state, so we can average over that, and smaller than the time of the decay, so we can trust this effective action. So if in this interval of time we do an average of the equation of state as a function of the amplitude of the shape mode, I mean, this should say theta, I guess, then we see that it's almost like a Nambu-Goto, where the pressure is the same as the tension, the energy density is the same as the tension, but there are corrections. And these corrections deviate the equation of a state from -1. And the interesting thing about this is that for 0.5, well, there are some departure, but it's not a dramatic departure. And of course, we cannot go to very large amplitude, because we know that very large amplitude, this time decay is going to be smaller. So this is telling you that, of course, in this action, you're not going to have vortons or anything very radical, because the deviation from the equation of state is going to be small. Okay, so this is, I think, something interesting. But so we started doing numerical experiments with this, and we found something even more interesting, which I think is more interesting, which was a little bit surprising for us, and that there are parametric resonance effects between the two modes, between the zero mode and the shape mode. Okay. So the experiment that I'm showing in this movie is the following. Let's just start with a straight string, and let's just put the shape mode. Okay, if you put just the shape mode, you would say, well, since this is symmetric along the direction of y, it's exactly the same experiment you did before, right? Nothing changes. I agree with that statement. Now let's perturb anything in the picture. And in fact, the way we found this out was by accident, by putting this in a thermal state. And what happens if you put any perturbation is this. You first have this shape excitation, but then all of a sudden you create another one, which is the zero mode is excited. Okay. So in fact, we can understand this as a parametric resonance of the amplitude of the standing wave because of the appearance of the shape mode. And one consequence of this is that the radiation, the amount of energy that you put in the shape mode, now decays much faster than before, because now there is an interaction between the shape mode and the standing wave and makes the thing leak faster.
But when you put the just the travel the oscillating modes, then that didn't go into the shape mode.
Sorry? Yeah, let me just continue because I think I have the answer for your question.
Okay.
But let me just try to explain this a little bit just in terms of equations. So we understand this in the following way. We can put an ansatz for the domain wall as the background domain wall that depends only on X, the transverse direction, plus the shape mode. This is the thing that we did before, right? But now let's imagine that you are allowed for some perturbation, some standing wave of the zero mode, which means this other one, right? So if you plug this ansatz in the equations of motion, and you go to the first non-linear order, you get an equation for this d, for the amplitude of the standing wave that has this form. So if you assume that the shape mode does not change, it's oscillating as it, nothing happens to him, then it back reacts on this term in such a way that you can transform this equation in the Mathieu equation. So then, I mean, you probably recognize this type of equation as a parametric resonance, right? And then you can identify the region in the area of the, in the plane of the amplitude of the shape mode versus the frequency where you're gonna have instabilities. Instabilities means that the amplitude of D, the amplitude of the standing wave is gonna grow, which is exactly what we saw. Of course, we don't go to amplitudes of the shape mode at 5. So we should only go to 1 at most. So it is more like this. But clearly all this region is a region of instability. So as long as the standing wave has a frequency which is half the shape of the shape mode, which is this, you're gonna have an instability. And this is exactly what we saw in the previous movie, okay? So answering the Tamir question, we can ask what happens with the other equation. So if here we fix the amplitude of the shape mode and we look at the amplitude of the standing wave. But we can do the opposite and look at the amplitude of the shape mode and go to the next order. And if you go to the next order, you see that there is a term that depends on the amplitude of the standing wave at the quadratic order. So now it means that this is now a normal resonance, right? A driven resonance, if you want. Now, if you put the standing wave with a frequency which is half of the shape mode, then you amplified the shape mode. So what happens is that at this particular frequencies, there's a way to go back and forth between the energy. In one way, because of the parametric resonance, in the other way, because of the normal resonance or driven resonance, if you want. So at that particular frequency, it's clear that things are going to get excited and energy is going to leak out. But if you go to lower frequency, and this is the frequency, by the way, remember the frequency of the shape mode is close to the frequency of the, it's close to half of the frequency of the vacuum. Okay, so pretty high frequencies. If you go to lower frequencies of the standing wave, then the non-Bogotá action should work and there shouldn't be any instability because, either way, if you put here a frequency which is not the one of the shape mode, this doesn't work, right? It doesn't drive anything. Okay, so I hope that this answers Tamir's question.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, so now to the real part that Tamir is waiting for, which is what happens now if I take two traveling waves, which I prepare with famous Bacchaspati initial conditions. You cannot see this very well, but here is a straight string, then you have some wiggles on it, and then a straight, and then another one. If you now put these strains in a collision course towards one another, you can read off the amplitude of the shape mode from this curve, okay? And then you see what happens. Well, what happens is that the collision excites the shape mode, but remember that the shape mode behaves as a massive scalar filling 1+1 dimension. So it's not gonna stay here, it's gonna propagate along the string, right? Now, in the meantime, the next collision happens. So eventually you create some amplitude of this shape mode. Now the amplitude is pretty small, okay? It's very small, but still you can see this effect happening. The amplitude is so small that the back reaction on the position of the string is negligible. But anyway, this is just to show that you can actually excite it, but the amplitude is probably very small. Okay, I think I should wrap up. So my conclusions are, I hope that I convince you that there are interesting things to study in these long-lived excitations of solitons. So solitons are not just the simple things, but they are actually complicated. They have these excitations that could affect their motion. In the case of domain walls, we've seen that they can be produced with 20% extra energy. In the case of global vortices, it's much less amount of energy. And in some cases, you know, if you get 20% of extra energy, this could affect their dynamics. There are some unexpected surprises, like this parametric resonance is not something that we thought in advance. We sort of discovered by accident. And this could be interesting. So the future experiments that we are doing is just going to study better the excitations of the main walls in 2+1 dimensions, not only for straight ones as I showed before, but actually networks where you can actually try to identify these excitations if they exist and if they affect the motion of these things. And of course, move on to 3+1 dimensions of local and global strings, and hopefully to get to the some understanding of the field theory networks so we can extrapolate them to cosmological situations. Okay, thank you. Sorry for the going extra time.
Thank you, Jose. Thanks for the interesting talk.
Yeah.
Do you have questions from the audience?
Yeah, so in our simulations of global string loops, I think we were finding this fattening of the string only where there was an intercommuting event.
Right.
So right. What do you think of that? Is that a way to excite these internal modes?
Yeah, I'm sure this happened. I mean, of course, we have not looked at this yet because there is no intercommutation in 1+1 or 2+1,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, my hope was that in the two-dimensional global vortex, we would see something like you know, some vortices that come and go by some interaction, and that would be enough to excite them. But it doesn't seem to be the case. Mm-hmm. Of course, the intercommutation is a much more dramatic thing, right? So I can imagine that these things get excited there. Now the only thing is that if I remember correctly, your simulation, it seems that the energy leaked quite fast. From the point of fattening, right?
Mm.
But if the calculation, if this excitation was of this kind, it should have stayed there for a long time. Of course, this is only assuming that the thing is straight. In your case, was also moving, so that's why I'm saying that it's
complicated.
It's complicated, yeah. Because now imagine that you get a straighter string excited because of this self-intersection, right? Or intersection. But then on top of that, you have the kinks that are moving away from it, the actual kinks,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And this could make the thing leak in a much faster way that the one that we're seeing here. In fact, part of what we saw here is exactly this, right? Here's this shape mode, and we know exactly how the shape mode decays because we studied in 1+1. That the moment that there is the parametric resonance, the energy that it leaks out is much faster.
Yeah.
So it could.
This is a funny simulation.
Well, I can tell you also that we thought for a long time that this was a bug, that this cannot be happening, but it actually seems to be actually true. So.
I see. So of course, there's one debate, which is the local strings,
right?
But that to me doesn't seem, I think in the end, it seemed like at least what we were finding was that it was the departure from Nambu Goto was due to some resolution issues.
Yeah.
But for the global strings, the departure seemed to be real.
Right, but...
And there is considerable debate in the global strings too.
Right. Yeah, so I was saying before, in the global string is more complicated by the fact that you have this force.
Yeah.
Due to the...
long range.
Goldstone, yeah. So that may complicate things. It's sort of a different channel also radiation. So the nice thing about these domain walls, for example, is this is standing wave. We have the idea that it shouldn't radiate, right? But we can actually test it. Of course, if you put in a global string, you will have radiation because you have a channel which is a massless field. So it's slightly harder. Well, I think it's a harder problem.
Yeah, but it's funny that it's a simple system, just two scalar fields. Yes. And we don't know what it does.
Well, I would say that even in the case of the main wall, it's a little bit surprising that there's this rich interplay between the two modes. I was not expecting. I mean, it's already quite complicated by this fact that, I mean, you may write this effective action that I wrote, but then radiation also
gets
away. So,
by the way, maybe I should introduce Omar to you. Omar is on the, he's working on the creation of defects.
Ah.
And there's Moinak, who is hiding behind his photograph.
Hello.
Moinak is working on certain quantum effects in kink scattering.
Yeah, I think I saw the paper recently.
But he's kind of following up on that.
Okay. Very nice.
So but this is very interesting. I mean,
So we hope to move on to the real situation at some point. We have some preliminary things, but
How are you going to do it? I mean, this is...
Oh, you mean to the 3+1?
Yeah.
So what I can tell you what we are doing at the moment. So we together with John and Johannes, we took their field theory simulations. So we extracted from them one large loop from the simulation, from the network. So this is the one that, you know, is supposed to be moving differently than Nambu Goto. We took the position. We did the same thing that we did here. We reconstructed the Nambu Goto. And so the idea is that in Nambu Goto, as you know, the energy is constant, right? So if the loop behaves as that, if you reconstruct the energy Nambu Goto different times, you should stay constant, right? So we did that. We compared the field theory motion with the Nambu Goto motion. And what we saw is that basically it agrees quite perfectly. I think I have a simulation here. Here. So this is, by the way, is extremely preliminary. What I mean by extreme preliminary is that this is the only loop we have done.
Okay. So this is, you've extracted from a big simulation.
Yes.
Okay.
So we take the loop from the simulation, and then we also reconstruct the Nambu Goto. And the Nambu Goto is drawn in white, and the field theory is in blue, and we gave it some thickness, which is related to the thickness of the string in field theory. Okay. Now you don't see anything in white here, because the Nambu is smaller and it's inside of this tube inside of this blue cube. Okay, so if there were departures, the white stuff would come out or deviate from the blue, right? So we evolve it, Nambu, and then you see some places where there are going to be departures, like here. See that?
Yeah.
That's, of course, okay, let me just stop there. Oops. That's, of course, a region where you were supposed to have a departure, because if you look close, you realize that there is a high curvature.
Yeah.
It's extremely high curvature there. The string wants to curve a lot.
So that's like a cusp almost.
Like a cusp, yeah. It's not not exactly a cusp, because we look at the velocities and not that high. But yeah, it's a high curvature region. So the string in field theory doesn't want to do that. Energy is chopped off, moved away. And of course, the Nambu Goto doesn't do anything. We are not taking self-intersections here. So we are just plotting the original Nambu Goto evolve in time. So what we did, so this happens. So what we did is to say, okay, of course, if you let this evolve forward, then you're going to see a departure from Nambu Goto later. But that's not correct, because what you know is that you should do is now reconstruct the Nambu Goto again.
Yeah.
So this is what we did. And this is why the white stuff is going to disappear in a second, because we are reconstructing Nambu Goto again. At this point on, and then continue. Okay, so now the Nambu Goto is still inside. There are some places where there are high curvature. And then at some point on the top, you see a little bit of white, but not much. But then there are some other regions that are going to appear here on the right-hand side of high curvature again, and also the top, you see here? But again, again, if you look at the thickness, which is given you by in blue, there is no hope that field theory is going to faithfully reconstruct this, because this is too high curvature. So, and then on the top, on the bottom here, right as well. Beginning here.
That's
okay. So our take on this is that field theory seems to do exactly what Nambu Goto does, except in regions where we did not expect it to do it, right? Places where high curvature is such that that field theory departures from Nambu Goto, which is, I guess, what we always thought could be possible.
Yeah. Now, so how about the same thing for global?
Yes, well, give us some time. But the point is that global is a little bit harder, as I said, because you cannot use Nambu Goto. You have to use Nambu Goto plus the Cal-Ramon part. And the Cal-Ramon part, as you know, is much harder because it's non-local, right? So you have to do something hybrid, some sort of back reaction type of thing. It's not just Nambu Goto. This is something that we will report hopefully soon, but we have to do many loops to convince ourselves that this is a generic situation.
Do we have questions from the audience? If no, let's thank Jose again.
Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you. Very, very interesting.
I can stay on if. But thanks for, by the way, thanks for staying up so late
and
talking to us. It's not.
Yeah.
How much is it?
11:30 here. But I go to bed later, so don't worry about it.
Yeah, I mean, that's in Spain, I guess it's early, no? You're going to look for dinner now?
Yeah, well. The kids are supposed to go to bed. But...
I see.
By the way, we also have this movie that I'm sure you like.
Yeah, show me more. Yeah, movies. Oh, this is Traveling Wave.
Exactly.
Oh, wow.
So this is in field theory. This is this Vachaspati field theory. See.
Oh, okay.
So no radiation solution, well, of course, because it's exact solutions.
Yeah, that's cool.
Well, there's not much, it's just going on. We're not...
By the way, these animations are really beautiful. The one that you just showed with the string and the white. That's a good idea.
These were all done by my student, Danny. Well, actually, all the simulations were done by him.
So I see.
He's probably working hard at this moment.
Good. All right.
Yeah. Thank you, Jose. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jose. Will you come to the seminar next? Do you go to the Tufts MIT ones regularly?
When they are online, yes. But
Will that be online next